Hello and welcome to another Century 21 Tech Talk briefing with me, Jeff Tracy. In this briefing, I'll be providing details about the operation and technical specifications of the Fire Flash. The Fire Flash is Air Terranean's new Mach 6 atomic-powered airliner, capable of carrying 600 passengers from London to Tokyo in under 90 minutes. The Fire Flash is a revolution in commercial air travel. The aircraft is 525 feet long, 82 feet in height, and has a wingspan of 250 feet. The Fire Flash was developed over a five-year period, and the design team included some of the greatest minds in the aviation industry. Before being unveiled to the world in mid-2065, the aircraft was put through rigorous safety testing and airworthiness trials. The main control cabin is mounted inside the tailplane, affording the crew a view of the entire craft. The instrument panels are the very latest design and include brand new technology, such as the thorium beam transmitter. The control cabin is situated directly above the engineering section, which houses the atomic reactor and is accessed by elevator. The atomic power system is another of Fire Flash's remarkable innovations. Just a few years ago, the idea of a commercial aircraft being powered by atomic energy would have been dismissed as fanciful. However, the reactor's shielding is serviced on a regular basis to ensure its safe operation. The first-class passenger lounges are mounted in the leading edges of the Fire Flash's wings. Kahelium-strengthened glass is used to maintain structural stability and to protect from the extreme heat of supersonic flight. The main passenger cabin is located in the central fuselage and is more luxurious than even the first-class services provided by other airlines. The port and starboard landing gear is housed within the wingtips of the aircraft, which are folded into flight configuration after takeoff. The lower deck of Fire Flash is dedicated to storage areas and vital avionic equipment. The aircraft also has space for a handful of automobiles, and these are loaded into the vehicle deck by a hydraulic elevator platform. The underside of the fuselage has a number of inspection hatches, which allow the main workings of the aircraft to be accessed. The ground crew checks everything, from the elevator power unit to the backup hydraulic systems. A typical departure for the Fire Flash can be summarized as follows. First, the aircraft taxis out of its purpose-built hangar, having been serviced and fueled. It stops at the terminal to collect passengers and load cargo. Once the doors and hatches have been sealed, the Fire Flash leaves the terminal apron and taxis to the end of its allocated runway. An automated signal beacon gives final clearance for takeoff before descending into the ground. The Fire Flash pilot engages full power, and the aircraft begins to roll along the runway, quickly gathers speed, and then lifts off. Once in the air, the Fire Flash climbs at a steep angle, passing through the sound barrier at 35,000 feet before engaging its reheat boosters at Mach 3. These incredible motors propel the craft to Mach 5.3 by the time it reaches 200,000 feet. As the aircraft begins to level off, it reaches top speed of Mach 6 and a final cruising altitude of 250,000 feet. Based at London Airport, the Fire Flash serves routes to France, America, Japan, and Australia. The latest announcement from Air Terranean states that they hope to open new routes to India and South Africa within the next 6 months. Despite its popularity with commercial organizations and the public alike, the Fire Flash has twice fallen victim to the evil intent of saboteurs. The first instance was during its maiden flight, bound from London to Tokyo. Tintin was traveling on board, the start of her journey to join the International Rescue Team. Shortly after leaving London Airport, the authorities were notified that a bomb had been planted in the landing gear of the aircraft, and that it would explode if the Fire Flash attempted to land. It would prove to be our first ever assignment as international rescue. Scott and Virgil proceeded to London at maximum speed, bringing with them our high-speed elevator cars. These flat-roofed vehicles have been designed by brains for just such an emergency. Taking direction from Scott, the Fireflash pilot and Virgil were able to coordinate a landing attempt, inching the giant aircraft down to the elevator cars racing along below. Applying maximum braking force, Virgil began to slow the speeding aircraft down. But the strain on the tires was too much, and the master elevator car, with Virgil inside, slewed out of control and crashed. The nose of the Fireflash dropped to the runway and skidded the last few feet to a stop. Thankfully, no one was hurt, and the bomb did not explode. The second sabotage attempt on the Fireflash tragically resulted in the deaths of everyone on board when Fireflash 3 was lost in the ocean. A subsequent investigation by the International Air Ministry concluded that a fault in the elevator power unit was to blame. However, International Rescue were called on to thoroughly test Fireflash, and Scott teamed up with Captain Hansen to fly the aircraft on the same course. During the flight, the EPU system failed, and Gordon was winched aboard to find the cause. He discovered that the wires had been cut by a saboteur, who fired on Gordon before jumping out of the open hatch. Gordon was able to repair the EPU circuit just in time to prevent the Fireflash from crashing into the sea. Since then, there have been no further attempts to sabotage the Fireflash, thanks in part to increased security measures as a result of the previous incidents. I trust that you enjoyed learning about the Fireflash, and hope that hearing about our involvement with the aircraft hasn't put you off flying on one again. Statistically speaking, it's still the safest way to travel. Thanks for listening, and I'll see you again for another Tech Talk Briefing. FAB.